is a Lucy. Please give me a brief introduction.
My name is Prithish Kumar. I basically belong to Puri. I have done my college from Vaisam Science College, Science. And I have done my graduation from University of Law College, Bhubaneswar, and post graduation from PG Department, Law, Pandi, Utkal University.
Okay. So, tell me, why are you interested for a career in judicial services? You could have, started practice, or you could have joined the civil service. What are the reasons why are you interested in judicial service?
Basically, judicial service are the judicial service is a forum that basically help one person to serve the society better. It is basically a judgment giving forum, and you basically decide the cases that come in front. Judiciary is basically, it is one of the pillars of the constitution that has been enacted by our great constitution makers, and it gives one person to serve the society in a better way, as it has been enshrined in the constitution. That is why I want to serve the judiciary.
Okay, so what were your options for the exam?
Options were Indian Penal Code and TOT and Transfer of Property Act, Specific Legal Act and Limitation, and Contract, Sale of Goods, Practice.
Okay. So tell me the ingredients of contract. What are the essential ingredients of contract and under which section you find them?
So basically, the ingredients of contract is it must be lawful according to section 10 of the Indian Contract Act 1872. The contract must be lawful, it must have a valid, it must not be against public policy, the parties must be major, and it must be for a consideration.
So what are the types or the kinds of contracts that you know?
Types of contract are one is a contingent contract, and one is
okay. So suppose I give a contract to someone to assault another person.
It will be void against as per section 25 for unlawful consideration.
Okay. Why?
Because it is against the public policy and against the society.
Okay. So contract, what is void and voidable?
Void contract is, this is basically a distinction that void contract is void from the very beginning of the contract, that is void ab initio. And voidable contracts are not illegal contract, they are dependent upon the other party, that is if he considers it as a not acceptable, he considers it as unacceptable, then it will be as a voidable contract. It is at his prerogative that the contract basically comes into force or doesn't come into. But it is basically different. The difference, basic difference is that the contract at the beginning, which is void ab initio, is void. That is, it cannot be enacted, and voidable contracts can be enacted subject to the practice.
Okay, what is a negotiable instrument? What is a negotiable instrument?
Negotiable instruments have been defined under section 13, and negotiation is defined under section 14 of the Negotiable Instruments Act 1881. And negotiable instruments are basically of three types, and that is a promissory note, bill of exchange, and check. And basically, these instruments are done to for a certain sum, for a certain amount of money, and is done in favor of a certain person to for a transaction, for doing some transaction.
Okay.
It can be of bearer instrument. It can be of order instrument.
What is the difference between bearer and order?
Order instrument, basically the difference is that in order instrument, the name that is provided or its or his order, the person, the contract is done in piece of paper, and here it is left, only the space is left blank, and whoever hears the check, hears the instrument, can encash it. And order only it is paid to that person whose name has been written.
So, in case of you know, the check bounces, what are the you know, consequences of a check bounce due to insufficient funds?
Misappearing of check. 138 which has been provided under section 138 of the Universal Disabilities Act. Basically, it provides that if the valid figure has been expired and the drawer has given a check which exceeds the arrangement, and such that the drawee is unable to honor the check for the payee, and in that scenario the check gets dishonored, and the circumstances are that the consequence is that there will be fine twice the amount of the check or 1 year or 2 years.
Okay, I am telling you a situation. Suppose I have money in my account, I have given a check to someone, okay, but I stop payment on that check. My account money is there, but due to some reasons I am stopping payment. Okay, so when he presents the check, that check is dishonored in the sense that it is stopped. Okay, in that case what will happen? I have the, you know, amount in my account.
Yes.
So will it be, you know, what action will be, or can action be taken against me?
Action can be taken against the drawee if he doesn't honor the wishes of the drawee. If there is sufficient amount in the account, then the drawee has to honor the drawer. That is, he has to provide the check. The amount to the payee who has presented the check.
Okay. So, tell me something about the doctrine of res judicata.
Doctrine of res judicata has been provided in section 11 of the Civil Procedure Code 1903, and it basically explains that once a suit has been filed in the court, no further suit will be heard on the same circumstances and same matter. This is doctrine of res judicata.
And what is the, you know, what is constructive res judicata?
Constructive res judicata has been provided in explanation 4 of the section 11 of the and it basically gives a reference that if the matter could have been decided in the civil, in the plain, and has not been given due regard by the plaintiff, then it would be constructed as a, it would act as a res judicata for any further litigation on the same, between the same parties and between the same, on the same subject and same matter.
What is the difference between a decree and a judgment?
Decree has been provided in section 2, clause 2 of Civil Procedure Code, that it is a formal expression of the court formal adjudication of the court, and it comes in a formal expression, and basically it is between the two parties. So decree and judgment, basically the difference is that judgment is pronounced in the open court, but decree is a formal expression of the court. It comes with the, it has the seal, it has the stamp, it has the name of the court. Judgment is the open pronunciation of the
court. In which case a decree will be void, or you can say, you know, nullity. What are the cases in which a decree will be said to be nullity?
In order 7, rule,
okay. So, tell me, what are the types of jurisdiction that you know?
There is a pecuniary jurisdiction as provided in section 15 of the Civil Procedure Code, and it is a
pecuniary jurisdiction is provided in section?
Section 6 and section 15.
Section 6 and 15. Then?
And it is a territorial jurisdiction that has been provided in jurisdiction is sometimes based on subject matter. That is, when it comes before the court, then court has inherent powers under 151 to decide whether it can decide.
So, tell me something about the concept of respondents.
Concept of respondents have been provided in section 52 of the Transfer of Property Act. That is, basically, if a party has transferred his property to another party, and the subject matter that is the immovable property is pending a decision before the court, then the transfer would be subject to the decision of the court. That is the final outcome of the property. That is based on the decision of the court as to whose property it is. It is to be whose property.
So, in your opinion, what are the reasons for the large number of cases pending in our courts, and how can it be solved?
Large number of pending cases. The basic reason is that there is a shortage of recruitment of judges, and as we have a very growing population, and the ratio of judges to people has been 1:1 to some 12,000 odd people. Then that naturally, and the trial period also that has been inside. In CPC it is written that it has to be within a definite period, that is within 30 days or within 15 days the judgment has to be. But that should be properly followed, so that there is a very much quick decision provided by the judges. That has to be enhanced. So the system.
Okay, have you heard the term alternate dispute resolution? Tell me some of the methods used in alternate dispute resolution.
Under section 89 of Civil Procedure Code and under order 10 rule 1A of the Civil Procedure Code, when the party comes to first time to the court, then the court can direct them to go for ADR. And under section 89 it has been provided four types of alternate dispute resolution, that is conciliation, mediation, Lok Adalat, and
so in contract, okay, what is the scope of arbitration, or what are the rules of arbitration in a contract? Okay. What are the recent amendments to the company law?
Company law 1956 existed before the enactment of the Companies Act 2013, and it has been in it there is a proposition of National Company Law Tribunal. And
so tribunals, okay, some of the judgments now of the Supreme Court are saying that the tribunals, rather than solving the cases, actually are increasing the cases, because even after the verdict of the tribunal, the people are coming to again the high courts and supreme courts. Okay, so can you tell me what is the reason that these tribunals were set up?
These tribunals are basically set up under the Companies Law Act, or are going to be set up under the Companies Law Act, that is the National Company Law Tribunal, to basically lower the pressure of the High Court and the Civil Court that are functioning in the country. But basically these companies are not, these tribunals are, do not have this prerogative to absolutely, they have not been mandated in the Company Law Tribunal that this prerogative would be provided to them to finally conclusively to settle down the case. So basically the dissatisfied parties, they are left with no other option but to come to the
solution. Okay. So your other optional you said, okay. In constitution, right? In the constitution of India, How many fundamental rights are there? Under Article 19, how many fundamental?
Six.
Six are there.
Before 1951, before the first constitutional law amendment, there was seven.
Mm.
Now there are six.
There are six. So right, where is property. That right to property that has been taken to which? 300A. Okay. So, what was the reason that it was removed from fundamental rights?
This is basically a big reason that after independence, the country was still under the Zamindari system, and so to abolish the Zamindari system, the states enacted the Zamindari Abolition Act. So after that, the first constitutional law came, constitutional amendment act came to as they sought their property as right to property. The right to property was left with the Zamindars. So the states that wanted to change this scenario and to basically give priority to the constitution, socialist state. So they came.
Have you heard about the doctrine of repugnancy in constitution? Doctrine of repugnancy. It is related to fundamental rights, or it is related to your powers of the center, union and the states. Doctrine of repugnancy.
Power of center, union, that has been given in the 7th schedule provided.
Yes,
the least.
This is also related to that.
7th schedule provides that union list, the state, the union list provides certain subject that is absolutely under the power of the union parliament to make laws on it, and the state list provides some subjects that are absolutely under the state law, but during emergency time the union can also make laws about the state, and there is a concurrent list which both state and union can
make. Okay. For every right, okay, you know, there has to be a remedy. Yeah, so can you tell me the
maxim?
Yes, maxim.
Bija se bhi remedy. Bija se bhi remedy.
Bija se
bhi
remedy. Okay, that is fine. Okay, so that will be the end of the interview. Thank you. Awesome.